This video is about the electrocyclic reactions, and particularly under thermal conditions. So this is with heating. So electrocyclic reactions take pi systems like this, and they undergo electrocyclization, where we form one new sigma bond and we lose one pi bond. So this can happen with different ring sizes. So here we've got formation of a six-membered ring. Here we've got formation of a four-membered ring. But in both cases, we just lose one pi bond and gain one sigma bond. Now, these are reversible reactions. Even if you see them drawn with unidirectional arrows, unless there's something special happening, they're going to be reversible reactions. And the equilibrium lies towards the side of the more stable product, obviously. And that will depend on the exact structural features of the product versus the starting material. So in this case, forming a six-membered ring is favorable. It's a nice ring size. It has good bond angles and so on. There's not much strain. And we're gaining that extra sigma bond while losing a weaker pi bond. Whereas when we form the four-membered ring, we're going from a non or unstrained acyclic diene to highly strained cyclobutene. So the cyclobutene is very strained. And so therefore that equilibrium for this electrocyclic process tends to lie on the open chain side. Okay, so how do these reactions work? Well, the important thing to look at in these reactions is the HOMO of the open form. So the form before we form that extra sigma bond. So if we draw out, for example, this hexatrain showing the p orbitals that are overlapping to make the pi system, then we'll get this depiction here. So that's overlap of six p orbitals. And I've drawn that out here, six p orbitals. When we overlap those p orbitals to make a pi system, we're going to generate six new molecular orbitals. And they're going to be at different energy levels depending on how the phases of each atomic orbital overlap. So we're going to have very low energy, a higher energy, and then this third energy level here. And then we're going to go above the energy of the atomic orbitals. So these are going to be antibonding orbitals up here. Okay, so if we have six p orbitals overlapping, each one is bringing one electron to the party. So we're going to have one, two, three, four, five, six. So the lowest three orbitals are going to be filled, and the top three orbitals are going to be unfilled. Now, with pi systems, we label these using the Greek letter psi. So this is psi 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then we can look at the ways that they can overlap, and that determines which are the most energetically favorable. So in the case of psi 1, it's all constructive overlap. So all of the p orbitals are overlapping in phase. So we can color one end of the p orbital on each one to show that they're all overlapping in phase. And we would say that that orbital has no nodes. So that has zero nodes. And a node is where we have a discontinuity between the overlap of p orbitals that are in phase. So let's show that with the second one here, psi 2. So if we draw out the atomic orbitals there, the first three will be in phase, and the second three will be in phase with each other. But between those two sets of three, we're going to have a node. Okay, so that's a non-bonding or antibonding interaction. So we've got one node, and then we can go forward with the others. So here we're going to have these two in phase, these two in phase, and these two in phase, and we're going to have two nodes. Okay, the next one up, psi 4, we're going to have this one like that, these two in phase, these two in phase, and then this one like that, and this is going to have three nodes. Psi 5 will have four nodes, so we're going to have these two out of phase, and then just one in-phase interaction there, like so. So our four nodes are going to be here, 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 and here. And then finally, Psi 6 is the highest energy because there's no bonding interaction. There's no p orbitals that are overlapping in phase with each other. So they just alternate like that. And so therefore we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 nodes. So 4 nodes here, 5 nodes here. And then we're normally most interested in what are called the frontier molecular orbitals. So this is the orbitals that are the highest occupied molecular orbital and the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. So if we label those, this will be the highest occupied molecular orbital, or the HOMO, and Psi 4 will be the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, or the LUMO. And for electrocyclic reactions, we're interested in the HOMO. So if we look at this, we've got this arrangement of phase. So let's go back to our earlier diagram and just color these in. Oops. Okay, now for this reaction to take place, we need to get those orbitals to come into constructive overlap with each other. So those two p orbitals have to go towards each other in a way that the same phases are overlapping. Now what I'm going to do is just make this a little bit more interesting by having a substituent on each one of these carbon atoms. So if we have substituents there, substituents there, how will the methyls be arranged on the product? So it turns out with electrocyclic reactions, there is a direct translation of the stereochemistry of these double bonds into the stereochemistry of the product. So I haven't drawn those methyls in, but I will when we've worked out which one is which. So actually what I'll do is I'll draw those methyls in red so that we can follow them more easily on a molecular model. Methyl groups. Okay, so I've got a model here, and it's got the full pi system of this hexatriene. So we've got all six of those p orbitals overlapping, and then I've got these red atoms here. They're just representing a methyl group. Okay, we wouldn't normally use red for a carbon group, but it makes it easy to follow with our diagram there. So if we look at this model, we need to get the p orbitals to overlap in phase with each other during the reaction that leads to the product. And to do that, one of them has to rotate like this, while the other one rotates like that. And we end up with the two methyl groups on the same face of the ring. So we would call that the cis product, and that's being generated from the EE triene, or the E geometry of each of the alkenes. Okay, so that rotation, one is rotating in one direction, the other one is rotating in the opposite direction, and we call this particular process a disrotatory process. Dis meaning dissimilar or different, so they're rotating in opposite directions. Okay, so we want to show that on our diagram, we can show that one is rotating this way and the other is rotating this way, and we're going to get them going towards each other on the same face of the ring. So therefore our product of this reaction is going to be the cis dimethyl cyclohexadiene. Okay, and just a reminder, we call that a disrotatory process. Okay, now, and the reason why that happens is that we have this particular arrangement of the phases on the HOMO, the these atomic orbitals here. We've got phases such that to get them to overlap, they have to rotate in a disrotatory manner. Now, we won't go through it in this video, but you can go through the same system to look at any electrocyclic process. So if we have a 4-carbon unit with 4 pi electrons, we go through this, we work out the HOMO, and in that case, we'll find out that the two ends that are needing to overlap are in opposite phase. And so in that case, we're going to rotate in the same direction, and we call that a conrotatory process. So we won't go through that in this video, but I will do another video about the photochemical electrocyclic reaction, which has a different set of requirements. Okay, so hopefully that sort of shows you how to look at an electrocyclic reaction under thermal conditions.